Art exists in many forms. I'm sure you've seen illustrations and sculptures, but what about illustrative sculpture? The Anton Art Center hosted local artist Jeff Jantz to exhibit his work behind his new book, Gruel, Snarl Draws a Wild Zugthing. His illustrative sculptures combine painting, sculpting, photography, and experimentation to deliver visuals that, well, pop off the page. We attended Jeff's author talk and book signing to find out a little more about his artistic process.
How you guys doing? Thanks for coming, everyone. I really appreciate you coming out and sharing our Zugthing universe with us. Really want to thank the Anton Art Center for hosting this, and thank Stephanie and all the other volunteers that work at the Anton Art Center. And I want to thank my wife and my mom and my dad for all the support they've given me all through the years, and ever since I was a little kid. And this has been something we've been working on for over 10 years, trying to get a book out there to the world. It's gone through a lot of different iterations and different areas and different explorations of trying to figure out what a book would look like if I was going to make a book, and trying to refine my writing skills and my illustration skills. And so when I first decided I was going to be an author, I started writing books and I started drawing the illustrations, and initially they kind of looked like a coloring book. So I realized I needed to get some work and figure out what my style was going to be. But then I realized I didn't want to do painting anymore, that I was tired of sitting at a desk and trying to paint. So I started sculpting and taking pictures, and that's kind of how I became to be an illustrative sculptor, is what I call it. And so I thought this book would be a really great one to do as an illustrative sculpture, because it's sort of got this play between two dimensions and three dimensions right within the story. So once I realized that I was going 3D, I started making sculptures. So this was the very first sculpture of Gruel Snarl. And this one, he doesn't move. He's a little bit scarier than the regular Gruel Snarl, the one that we came to know. So I sculpted this guy. I created an illustration. This little postcard right here is a postcard. When you have a chance, you can come take a look at this. That was like the very first three-dimensional illustration of Gruel Snarl. I sent that out to some publishers and some agents. And I realized that I needed to figure out a way to make this a little bit cuter, and figure out some way that I could make multiple of him so they would be the same. So I started experimenting with some different techniques. This was actually the second version of Gruel Snarl. I was trying to make him more poseable. So this guy is actually made of wire and foam and a whole bunch of latex. So I was trying to make a poseable one, so I thought this would be like a really easy way to do it if I could make one and then just pose him over and over. But it wasn't really, I don't know, he's a little bit like scarier version of Gruel Snarl. So I thought, yeah, I don't know if this is going to work. I want Gruel Snarl to be a cuter little alien. This guy's just not cute enough. So I went back to the drawing board. I started experimenting a little bit more, and I got this one. His body is made of polymer clay, so it's pretty hard. So it's oven-baked clay. His arms are poseable with latex, and I created molds to create his arms. So he has latex arms and legs with a wire armature underneath. And then his face is actually modeling clay, so his face, I could actually peel it off and then create a whole nother face for him. So I was getting closer. I started to feel like this is a little bit more like what I wanted Gruel Snarl to look like. And so what I sort of ended up coming to is what you see over here, what you see all the rest around the room, is these other versions of Gruel Snarl that kind of take a note from Mr. Potato Head. So there's nine separate bodies for Gruel Snarl. They have a little bit different gesture to them. Some of them, his back is curved just a little bit more or turned a little bit. This one's kind of got a little bit of a twist. So there's nine different bodies. There's about 20 something different arms that have different gestures. Some of the arms are partially poseable. And then he still has some of them, the face can still be peeled off, so some of his cheeks and his face and his lips and his teeth, they all kind of pop off just like Mr. Potato Head. And his eyelids, of course, so I could change the facial expressions. So I'll spend like hours just kind of getting things just right. I move it over just a little bit, and then move it over, then move his arm, and then move this, and move the other thing. But I want to make sure that whatever he's looking at, you really feel like he's looking at that. So then sometimes I have to peel off his eyeball, his pupil, and then move that over just a little bit. So the props, I actually utilize a 3D printer for some of the props. If there's some things that are a little bit more geometric, like the rockets. So this rocket right here is one of the props. You find that in a couple of pages of the book. And then there's 3D printed versions of the rocket there that you can buy. If any kids would like to take one home and paint it for themselves, you can try that out. This is made from some old computer parts. Let's see, what else we have here is some scrap aluminum. There's things made out of clay. The little candy in there is just beads. So there's all kinds of funny little things that we use. So this is what it would look like in the studio. Sometimes we set up a couple of them at a time. Jamie's sort of my test subject. I'll ask her if the lighting looks right, and she'll tell me if there's too much shadow here. It's always good to have that extra person to get feedback from, so you're not just working all by yourself. But so yeah, this is pretty much what it would look like. This set is really close to what it looks like in that illustration. There's a little bit of extra blank paper and some other stuff in the background. But so yeah, I would set this up. And then in some cases, if there's like similar sets, I might set them up at the same time to try and get some kind of continuity match going. And then I'll probably come down a couple of days after work for a few hours and try to get everything just right and like maybe move this up and then move it over a quarter of an inch, and then move it back another quarter of an inch, and go back and forth until I got it just right, and then lay the crayons around so that you can see them all, but it doesn't look like they were purposely placed there, even though they were purposely placed there. So this is the ripple in space. We could have probably, this is the illustration that in the very first spread of the book, there's the ripple in space. So this kind of came to me from the idea of a wrinkle in time, if anybody's ever read the book, A Wrinkle in Time. So I wanted to figure out how could I do a ripple. So normally when I do paintings and backdrops, I do it on plywood. Mm-hmm. You don't have to stretch a canvas, but you can't bend a piece of plywood, not very easily anyway. So I wanted to be able to sort of be able to control where the ripple would be and how it would look. And then I probably spent a week or so, like every day coming home from work and then getting up here and working on this painting till 1 o'clock in the morning and trying to get layers and layers of paint on there. And then the earth here, this is actually just a 3D printed globe, and then we hand painted that to look like earth. So yeah, it was pretty time consuming. I think we spent, there was at least 4 months of just making props, sets, and figures before we even started the photography part. So there's a lot of experimenting. That's why Dr. Jantzer is kind of our mascot, and he's sort of a mad sculptor / scientist, is because when you're making stuff out of sculptures and you're using found objects, you kind of have to be a scientist sometimes. You have to try to experiment with different things. Like when I was doing my silicone trials and trying to figure out how I could make clay out of silicone, because you can buy silicone that you can pour into molds and make stuff out of, but it's not like, it's still not, it's more liquidy, it's not really sculptable. So I thought, well, how can I make silicone that's like clay and then use it? And how can I, and also the stuff that you buy is like, it's like $50 for like two little containers, so, but you can buy a tube of silicone caulk for like $3, so. So there's a lot, I spent like weeks just experimenting with silicone to see what I can do. So there's really none of, I did that all after Gruel Snarl. So hopefully the next book I'll get to use some of these silicone tricks that I figured out. It was 8 years worth of rejections. So with Gruel Snarl, this is actually the first publisher that I sent it to. But that's mostly because publishers, most of the big ones, won't take your submissions anymore unless you have an agent. So I went through a bunch of rejections from agents first. So with Gruel Snarl, I think with him, with this book, there was probably only 10 rejections maybe from agents. But I mean, there was so many other rejections from other books. But it's that honest feedback that maybe hurts at first, but is really the helpful feedback, which is what made me realize, okay, well, maybe, you know, I don't even really like drawing on the, you know, I was trying to draw stuff and then scan it in and color it with Photoshop, and Jamie ended up having to like spend hours trying to teach me how to use Photoshop, and I wasn't very good at it, and I didn't really like it, so it was good that somebody said, hey, this looks like a coloring book, because I realized that I didn't really want to be doing that kind of illustration work anyway, so.
Yeah, Helen, which sculptor do you absolutely
like? I really like the guitar one, so I'm really glad this was actually the publisher's call was to put that one on the back. I had proposed a different back cover, and actually I think what we had originally had originally in there for the back cover was just the Who's Drawing Who photo with the two hands drawing each other. It's sort of, I don't know if anybody's familiar with Escher, there's a sample of Escher over there. So that was what I just had for the back cover, and then the publisher proposed using this for the back cover, and I thought that was pretty great because I really like that pose. I don't know, just sort of gives a pretty good idea of what Gruel Snarl is really like. He's kind of a wild, hyperactive kid. Pretty much like a regular Earth kid, except for he's green and one eyeball and pointy ears, but kind of hyperactive like I was when I was a kid, and the only time he really can calm down is when he's drawing something or making artwork, which is pretty much how I was when I was a kid. So it's really sort of an autobiography. So just don't tell too many people. One thing that's kind of interesting, I think, is that the book also includes a free audiobook. And so when I was growing up, I actually really didn't like to read as a kid at all because I was dyslexic, so it was really hard for me to read. And so the only books that I really liked to read were the ones that came with the little cassette tape. So this was way back in the 80s, so little kids might not know what a cassette tape is. But so we would go to the library, and I'd go to the back where they had the bags hanging up on the rack, and there was books with little cassette tapes. And that was pretty much the only way my mom could get me to read, was if I had an audiobook to go with it. So when I finally got to the point where I was getting a book published, I just knew that I had to have an audiobook with it.
Great job.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
To learn more about Jeff Jantz, Gruel Snarl, and the other works of Jantzer Studios, find them online at jantzerstudios.com.
In an intergalactic dimension, on the other side of a ripple in space, there lived a kid
Zello.
Named Gruel Snarl. Gruel spent his days doing all kinds of things.
Too loud.
You know better. That will break.
Zoom, zoom, zoom!
You are driving me zonkers, Gruel. I need to find something else for this kid to do.
Zada!
I'm going to draw wild Zug things from out of this world. My next one will be the wildest Zugthing of them all! Gruel's next drawing was so wild that it jumped right off the page!
Ah!
To find out what happens next, look for Gruel Snarl Draws a Wild Zugthing at a book retailer in your universe. Free read-along audiobook download included.